Ashamed of what I've done, what I've become. These hands are dirty. I dare not lift them up to the Holy One. You plead my cause, you right my wrongs, you break my chains, you overcome, you give your life to give me mine, you say that I am free, how can it be? Can it be? Yeah. I've been hiding, afraid I've let you down. Inside, I doubt that you still love me. There's only grace now. You plead my cause, you right my wrongs, you break my chains, you overcome, you give your life to give me mine. You say that I am free, how can it be? Yeah. How can it be? Yeah.
Though I fall, you can make me from this death, I will rise with you. Oh, the grace reaching out for me. How can it be? How can it be? Chains, you overcome, you gave your life to give me mine, you say that I am free, how can it be?
Of what I've done, what I've become, these hands are dirty. I dare not lift them up to the Holy One.
Let's pray together. God, I thank you that though we're guilty, you set us free. For anyone in this room, God, that does not know that freedom, may they realize it today. In your name we pray. Amen. Hey, y'all go ahead, sit down. Wait a minute, don't go. Stay put. Stay right there. Just you. This is Gary Doyle. He's a drummer. And the reason he feels weird is because we introduced everybody else last week and you weren't here. All right, so just a couple of things. One of them, you know what? They're both odd to church, so. Okay, so the first one is, you notice we didn't pass an offering plate, so if you're not new to church, or if you are new to church, it's not going to make any difference. If you're not new to church, you're probably wondering. I think I had it right. So we do that in a basket. So they're at the doors. And we want you to give as God leads. We don't want you to give because something came across your plate. Yeah, like that. So we just want you to pray about how you give. We still want you to give. Right? And all the finance team said, yeah, okay. So be sure and use those offering baskets if you don't mind. The other thing, this is only, I don't know, this is weird. So we have a lot of batteries that I want to give you. They're hearing aid batteries. No, so literally, sometimes we get stuff through our market that it's hard to give away. So I want to make it available for you all if you need hearing aid batteries, that you can come get them after church. I'm going to lay them up here at the altar. Nobody's going to. $6.75. Oh, they're all $6.75. I mean, I don't even know what that. Anybody uses $6.75?
Does anyone use $6.75?
Okay, we tried. We're going to lay them there. Maybe you know a friend who needs $6.75. Where are the kids at? Come on up here. Kitties. What? I did. He said we got baskets at the door. What hearing aid battery are you using? He might need to use a $6.75. Awesome. Hey. Easter's coming. Did y'all know that?
Yeah.
I know. I heard you got a friend coming to town. So, since Easter's coming, we have a pretty big. Easter's kind of a big deal in the old church world thing. So we're gonna have a big Easter egg hunt on Easter morning for you all while we're having big. Are you from out of town? You're not gonna be here. You gonna be here? No. Well, you should tell them you need to stay. I mean, a good Christian would stay through Easter. Remember that whenever you leave and go back up north. Good Christians stay through Easter. So here's what we need from them. So I'm about you here. So while you're still staying here, I'm going to let them know. These guys need to hunt Easter eggs on Easter morning, but you all need to help us do that by bringing in some plastic Easter eggs with stuff in them. Not chocolate. That's not good in Florida. Okay? It's just Jell-O at the end of the day. So, plastic eggs, they really like to hunt money. Good. Yeah. It's kind of like our finance team. Every Sunday morning, they go to these baskets and they look for money. Yeah, it's the same. So, yeah, they like that. So if you'll bring in some money in eggs, that'd be great. We have some eggs if you can't find Easter eggs, which I think would be silly. We have a bunch of empty ones. You can take them, fill them, and bring them back. Or if you're just want to bring the stuff, we'll help you fill them. So we need eggs and we need stuff. And we got 2 weeks, right? Three Sundays? Okay. So 2 Sundays to get them in is what I meant. So 2 Sundays. So that's it. Where's, can you find Miss, there she is. Scared me. Miss Mary's taking you. We call her Crazy Mary. Y'all will figure that out in a while. We do all have nicknames here. I don't know if you probably don't know your nickname. Getting a lot of compliments on the shirt this morning. Even online right now, people are watching. So it's, Hi, John and Tammy. They're watching online. So. There's a 22-second delay, so right about now they got your kiss. So that's pretty cool. Good. If you want to grab a Bible, or grab a YouVersion, or grab whatever you've got, look over your neighbor's shoulder. We'll bounce around a little bit, but we'll be near Nehemiah 1 as we go. We're gonna finish up what we've been talking about for 3 weeks, being divine direction, and we've talked about decision-making and how it's kind of hard for not only this generation to make decisions, but us around this generation, in this generation, is having trouble making decisions. And we talked about how not making a decision has become the norm and just kind of letting it ride. And sometimes that becomes a bad decision, even worse than a regular bad decision that you would have had. So today we're going to kind of look at that and wrap it up. And I hope that in some way, somebody in here is stirred. I believe it'll happen. You're stirred to do what God has been asking you to do, to go ahead and make the decision today, that you will, what we're going to call today, divine burden, that you've identified it, and you know it's from God, you're just having trouble committing. And we talked last week about that first step that, you know, or that step that God only gives us one at a time and lights our path, and those are our verses. But today, that you actually do it, that you jump into it at least a little bit, that you take a step. Let's remember today, to do that, to step towards something new requires us to step away from something old. And that's sometimes what holds us back. Familiarity, just where we are. I mean, if you're, certain people would call it a rut, you know, you kind of got your habit, your program, your path, and you're on it, and it doesn't really, it's not conducive to you to change. You really don't want to because of that comfort and familiarity. So I want to just remember, to do this, you're going to have to step away from something in order to step towards something else. I mean, it could be that you're going to start school. You're going to start a new class. You want to, no matter what age you are, that you just decided you want to learn, you felt like you want to learn something new. So you're going to start that. You're going to do the first step in that. You're going to get it. You're going to, maybe some of you are single. You're going to start a new relationship, and you really feel this pressing of God towards it, and it's time. It's time for you to make that step to move forward. Maybe you're going to start a business. Maybe you're going to start a ministry. Maybe you're going to go on a trip. Maybe you're going to go somewhere. Maybe you're, anything. It's anything. It's absolutely anything that whatever God has burdened you with that you do, that you actually will just start to do it today. You know, I don't know what it is about that process. We like to see the after, right? Don't you like to see the before and after pictures of these females on the internet? You know, they used to weigh like 282 pounds, and today they're 127 pounds, size 2, right? You like that? I mean, it's rewarding for them, and it's incredible. It should be encouraging for us, but really you just want to snap their little heads off. Right? Right? You're just like, yeah, right, Photoshop. Shouldn't really do it, yeah. You know, you see those exercise programs, right? And they're on those exercise machines. Oh, do y'all stay up watching the Home Shopping Network? See, I have a grandmother. I think my dad says my mom's kind of like that. They watch the Home Shopping Network, and if the new one comes on, they get it. We've had so many exercise equipments when I was growing up. Clothes on. They make great clothes hangers. They do. But have you ever seen them? You see people on there, and they'll show a before and after. And this person is like buff, you know, he's like cut, and I'm looking at him, I'm like, the machine's brand new. How did you get to look like that on a machine that's brand new? Just doesn't happen. But we see that, and we kind of get, but they used to look like that regardless of what they did, but they had to make that first step. They had to decide to do something about the way they looked or the way they felt or the way they, how much they weighed, whatever. They had to decide to do it. And regardless of how long it takes, I mean, if you're like me, I like to have a diet that changes my weight in 2 days. It does. I haven't found one, but I would like one. And I would probably start one if they had a promise of 2 days result. But really, we look at that and we seem to forget that they had to start, that they had, that it, at one point there had to be a step towards that direction. They had to move. And so often you and I don't even make the first step because we get bogged down in what it's going to take in between. We're going to look over at the Old Testament. And I'll give you a little backstory. I love this story. We've told this story. And what's really cool about Bible stories is that they work for a lot of different things. And when you get down into the meat of the story, all this stuff that can come out of them for different areas of our life and for different seasons of our church or for whatever. This story is about Nehemiah. And you know about Nehemiah if you've been here. And just in case you're new to church, let me tell you a little bit about Nehemiah. Nehemiah got a burden. Okay, so he had this, what we call divine burden, that he wanted to rebuild Jerusalem. He really wanted to actually just rebuild the wall. Because what had happened is that the people of God had become non-worshipful. Okay, they had just kind of turned their back on God. And what God allowed was for the Babylonians to come in and destroy it. I mean, just every single stone in Jerusalem was turned. That's a Bible prophecy. But it was completely obliterated, torn down. And it really... it bothered a lot of people, but they didn't really know what they should do. And along comes Nehemiah, who was a general contractor. Right? No, Nehemiah wasn't a general contractor. Nehemiah was a... What? Oh, y'all really don't know the story. Okay. Once there was a man named Nehemiah. No. So Nehemiah was a cupbearer. Thank you. He's a cupbearer. Y'all know what a cupbearer is, right? Got to drink before the king got to drink. Yeah. So if what he drank was poison, the king said, pass. Great job. Horrible turnover rate. Seriously, it was. It was bad. So that was Nehemiah's job. And Nehemiah got this burden. He looked at Jerusalem. He looked at the people. And he said, This bugs me, and I believe I need to do something about it. So he gets this burden, and we're 140 years down the line of when the Babylonians, they have been this way for 140 years. How many of you all, when you look at something that's been going on for 140 years, you just look at it and go, there's no change in that? A lot of us, don't kid yourself. Nehemiah looked at that and said, man, this isn't good. Man, this is God's place. This is God, we're God's people. This is not okay by me. And as long as I'm alive, I just don't think we're going to allow this to happen anymore. I'm not going to stand for this. So this divine burden came on to him. And for you, this divine burden is going to come on you for something. Because you're a Jesus follower, and because you're a Jesus follower, he's going to put this thing inside of your heart, and he's already been doing it, or he's bugging you about it, and you just feel like I got to do it, I don't know what to do, or how to do it, but there's something you can do, you just haven't been able to do it. Your divine burden, you know, your heart aches on behalf of what God wants you to do, of what he's asking you to pull out of your life, to commit to doing, you know. It could be, anything, absolutely anything. These don't have to be big things. Y'all remember Popeye? Oh, Popeye, not Nehemiah, but Popeye, yeah. I like it. What did Popeye do whenever, do y'all remember the phrase he said right before he ate his spinach? Not on Popeye, that was after he ate the spinach. Yeah, when the horn blew, that was after the spinach. But right before the spinach, he said, that's not the phrase I'm looking for. He had to said something else. No, he said, I've had all I can stand, and I can't stand no more. Right? I mean, he hit the wall. I mean, he just kind of, he came up to this. That's what Nehemiah is at. And I hope you're getting there. You're already there. That you've looked at what God has asked you to change or to do, and you're like, I can't stand it anymore. I just have to do it. And I think that's where we see Nehemiah. He has his Popeye moment. He kind of comes to that point that he has to make his burden go away. I mean, the least likely guy to do this job. I mean, wouldn't it have been easier to find a general contractor? Even a subcontractor. Okay, even a day laborer. It would have been better to have, you know, in our minds. Because, take note of that, because God asks you to do things not necessarily because you're cut out for it. I hate that word in the Christian language. I'm not cut out for that. Listen, you're cut out in the image of God. That's what you're cut out for. So when God has a plan and he puts it on your heart, trust me, you're not qualified to look back at him and go, I'm not cut out for that. Because literally he's looking at your life going, no, I cut you out for that. This is what you're cut out for. But I thought I was really good at electronics or being an electrician. No. You might be, but this burden that you've got, I cut you out for this. And I'll equip you as you need to be equipped. I'll give you the energy. I'll give you the knowledge. I'll give you, remember, step by step by step. I want to get it. You'll get it as God deems you need it. So what's the first thing Nehemiah does? He's a good Christian. What's he do? Good answer. So Nehemiah gets a burden, and he prays. And that's great. But he doesn't pray, you know, show me all of it. He doesn't pray, God, you know, you really could find somebody better. He doesn't really say, okay, God, I need you to open some doors. You know, or he doesn't pray, now, I know you're asking me, but if you know what, if you'll make the path easy, I'll commit, and I'm going to go test the waters. No, he doesn't. Nehemiah is headed. Let's look at Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 5. It's kind of, this is his prayer. Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. Oh, I didn't give you any more of that. Did I give you 6 and 7? I really meant to. I'll give you the high points. He's basically saying, I'm going to go talk to Susa, who is the king. I'm going to go talk to him, and I need you to give me favor. You know, that basically, step one, okay? Step one, I pray. Next step, I know where I've got to go. I've got to go talk to Susa. Yeah, there you go. I'm going to go talk to Susa, and I need the favor there. I need the favor of him. I need his permission. You know, for Nehemiah, he was working for Susa. Now, if you're Nehemiah, you know, remember, you're the cupbearer. You know you're not qualified to do the job you're getting ready to ask Susa to let you go do. You understand that when Susa gives permission, that's God confirming to Nehemiah what he did. But understand, Nehemiah didn't ask for the confirmation. He simply took the step. If the first step is to get permission, Nehemiah went to get permission. Whatever your first step is, you have to help get God to help you identify that and then take the step. You have to get started. You have to move in the direction. So it begs the question, how do you start something big? And many of you are hoping you're off the hook right now. Because I said start something big. And you're like, oh, I don't really have a burden to start anything big. Well, let's qualify big for a minute. To a Jesus follower, anything that God asks you to do is big. Absolutely anything. I don't care if it's start a business or if it's start a Bible study group. I don't care if it's start a church. I don't care if it's get a new job. I don't care if it's just be the husband and father that God has called you to be. You know, you got a burden to be this or that. No matter what it is, if he called you to do it, it's really big. So how do you do something really big? You start small. You start with the smallest step. If you're going to pay off a debt, or if you're going to get, I don't know about you, but I've been, haven't let my kids look at Dave Ramsey stuff and kind of coach them through that. And you know that emergency fund? Y'all know what an emergency fund is? Shameless plug for Dave Ramsey. You ought to read his books. He's really good at it. You need an emergency fund. That's $1,000 in the bank at all times you don't touch unless you have an emergency. And if you spend it, you rebuild your emergency fund before you do anything else. Pretty good advice. But whenever I looked at that, whenever I started reading, and $1,000 to me was like, oh, I don't know, a couple million. How do you put $1,000 in the bank? Dollar at a time. Yeah, maybe it's you sell something on eBay. Maybe you don't go out to dinner or buy the coffee that day, and all of a sudden you're $85 towards your $1,000 goal. Whatever it is, there's a way to get started. There's the small way. It wasn't I had to go make $1,000 and then set that aside and that was going to be it. No, the step is to get to it. The steps to move toward it. So it's to do the smallest that you are able to do. The things that God has put in your path that you can do, you qualify it and you move on towards it. One step at a time. How you do something big? You start small. Start small. Look at Zechariah 4:10. I love this. Who dares despise the day of small things? Since the seven eyes of the Lord that range throughout the earth will rejoice when they see the chosen capstone in the hand of Zerubbabel. Now this is a story of the small things getting started. It actually goes on and it says, God rejoices in the beginnings. God rejoices in the beginnings when you take the step. Now here's the best way I can put it in the hands of us today. Have you ever, so you've all been kids, I get that, but how many of you all have kids? How many of you all have grandkids? Yeah, so your hand, you had to have had a kid prior to having a grandkid. Some of you only raised your hand for the grandkid thing. I feel like I'm going to understand that at one point. You know, you just forget that generation existed and like, oh, we're going to start over. Yeah. I get that. I'm starting to understand. I don't have grandkids, but I am starting to understand it. You know, didn't really happen. You remember around age one-ish, and they did the Frankenstein walk? And they take that step? It's the thing that turns really proper adults into raging idiots. Right? You're like, yay! You know, you start dancing. I walked in the door the other day, band practice, and Noah's sitting on the front pew, and he did something really funny, and I'm just like, oh, yeah, and I started talking like a, I don't know what, silly, and Craig goes, isn't it funny how kids make you look like an idiot? Now, that was a compliment. It really was. But you remember that. And then they take that first step, and you just, whoa, you took your first step. That's God. You took your first step. Now, they're going to fall. You're going to fall. How many of you, after they took their second step and they fell, you went, oh, you stupid little kid. What's wrong with you? You had it going. No. You help them back up. You're like, do it again. Just keep going. You'll get it. Right? That's God to his children. As we take that step, he gets so excited. He's going to, yes, he's coming in my direction. He's going the way, yes. And you're going to fall. It's okay, get up, come on. It's okay. Keep moving. It's not going to be easy. If it was easy, he could have just made us born ready to walk. Right? No, we had to learn. Taking that step towards him or with him, same way. You don't just come to Christ and all of a sudden have the ability to walk in that direction. You have to learn. You have to trust. You know, when I firmly believe from the kids' eyes, as dads or parents, or grandparents, have their hands out. and the kids are trying to take that step. They're working on that trust, right? That's why we're taught in Parenting 101, when they first take that step, you don't go, don't do that. It twists the kid for a while. You don't want to do that. We got one. I might have done that too. I don't know. You know, you got to test rules. You know, you're told that stuff, but you got to test it every now and then just to see if they're actually telling the truth. No. But that I believe they're testing it. And that's okay with you and God and your relationship. It's okay to test your trust in Him. It's okay to take a step and see if He's really God. Not see if He's really, you know, see if He's really telling you to do it. I don't like that. But to see if He'll act. You already know He's telling you. But to see, test your dependence and your trust. Just take that step and then see if He just crushes you. No. Take that step and fall. And He'll pick you up. If you look at what Nehemiah did, it's really crazy. Right? If you go to the very end of what happened with Nehemiah, and you trace back the steps, the small steps, it's really encouraging. So I kind of wrote them down in backwards, so I got to read them so I don't forget them. So you go back one step from finishing the wall, they just pretty much worked their butt off, right? And you go back a step before that, and you find them working their butts off with weapons in one hand and tools in the other hand. And you go back another step, and you just find them kind of working their butts off, you know? And then you go back another step, and you find some opposition. You remember last week we talked about opposition, certain uncertainty. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. You know, you got all those guys that came from the regional king, and he's telling you can't do this. You're not supposed to do this. We're going to fight you down. You go back another step, and you see Nehemiah, and he's encouraging the people. He's like, listen, it's not going to be easy. We're going to fight, and we're going to work. And you go back another step, and you find him just trying to convince people, work on your spot of the wall. He went to each family, and he was like, okay, go out of your house, look where there was not a wall, put a wall. Pretty simple instructions. Don't look all the way around the city and go, oh, there's a big wall. Walk out your door. Where there's no wall, put a wall. Pretty encouraging. You go back another step, and you find Nehemiah just wandering around, surveying the things. Not really, you know, he's kind of taking in the project, you know. He's looking at it. We're told he took 3 days to do that. He just kind of wandered around. You go back a step, and you find him riding on a donkey. 850 miles. Explains the 3 days. Think about it. 850 miles on a donkey, I'd probably rest a little longer in 3 days. Go back a step before that. You have him packing his bag. You know, go back a step before that, and you've got him asking for permission. But he gets permission and takes that step. He goes home and packs a bag. Put his toothbrush in. Listen, maybe for some of you to take this step, you need to pack a bag. Be ready. I know I've been using my kid, and this was not by design that my kids have been going, what, my design? But it's probably by design. My kids are going through things and using these tools that I'm talking to you about in their lives right now. I got one kid that's like, okay, I'm just going to start using names because I've run out of one kids, right? Okay, so this one's Staples Allen, dreadhead, you know, looks like a, yeah, whatever you want to call him. I've probably called him that. It's no big deal. So he's got this, he's got a plan. You know, he feels, you know, he's got his captain's license. He's gone and done boats. You know, he's been in the Bahamas. You know, he's a big shot, you know, rides on big boats with big people and takes them places, you know, but he hates it. No, he hates it. I mean, to me, I'm like, dude, it's the cushiest it gets. You know, you should be doing that, you know, and you're really good at it. And that's what I'm telling him. And he's like, remember at week two, I'm like, we taught our generation, if you don't love it, don't do it. So he gave my words back to me, but I don't love it. Fair enough. I said, so what do you want to do? He said, I want to play music. I want to play music with my brother. and I see us, and he's like, I see us doing XYZ, and he's kind of got this plan that's been, we'll say given to him. It could be anything that gave it to him, but we got this plan. I'm like, are you ready? No? No? Well, where are you going to live? Well, we're going to live in that bus. No, I'm behind that. Okay, so I have one, okay? When I retire from here, I'm living on a bus. So don't knock that. It's good. So my kids bought a school bus, another one. It's the ugly one because they're not as good as I am. So anyway, he looks at that and he goes, I'm going to live on that with my brother. And I'm like, did you ask your brother? Because that'd be like step one, you know, get permission to live on the bus. But the bus isn't ready. It's like halfway converted to living. And I'm like, son, look, if you're sitting here saying you're ready for the next step, and you haven't finished the first step, you're not going to get the second step. So when you're out here wandering around going, my life is so bad, I don't know what I'm going to do. I really want to go play music, and I don't know. And I'm like, you really feel like you're supposed to live on the bus, and the bus ain't ready to live on. Get your butt to work on the bus and make it ready to live on. Then you can sit on the porch and go, now I'm ready. Now I'm ready. So I had that talk with him like Monday, and Monday afternoon, he cleaned his entire room. I mean, threw away everything. I walked into his room, and he's got this case, one case, and he goes, that's my existence, my instruments. I can live in that case. He said, I'm ready to get on the bus. I'm like, but the bus still ain't ready. But it was a start. It was a start. It was a start. It was a start. Go, you know. Y'all, if y'all watch Tiny House, we're like Tiny House. We love them, okay? I'm like, you pared down awesome, dude. Now, don't bring anything back in here, but get the tiny house ready, you know? But that's it. It's we all have the ability to do this next step. We tell God we're ready, and he's like, no, I told you what the next step was to get ready. You know, we've got our picture of the grand plan, and we're ready for the grand plan, God. And God's like, no. Just do that one, and then tell me you're ready. Because I haven't even given you the whole grand plan. I've given you a burden. I've given you a desire. Pack a bag. Put your toothbrush in your pocket if that's all you need. Whatever it is you need to be ready to go to the next step after you've completed that step, do that. Do that. Be ready. God's always ready. It's you and I that aren't. Nehemiah goes on. We're going to skip some of those. Nehemiah goes on, and he's like, and when he starts to get them rebuilding and pushes them on and pushes them on and pushes them on. Because he can see how it's going to happen as he takes each step. Each step brings Nehemiah closer to seeing it done. Do y'all know how long it took Nehemiah and the crew of merry men to build the wall? No? Somebody does. Who? 52 days. Took them 52 days. It's still today what's considered one of the greatest construction feats on the planet, to rebuild an entire wall in 52 days. What's interesting is that when Nehemiah got done with the wall, he went back to being a cupbearer and said he was done with God's work, right? No. See, this is why we started this. We called it divine direction. It's not divine destination. Because as soon as the wall got done, Nehemiah turned his attention to the temple. And as soon as he got the temple done, he turned his attention to the economy and to God's people becoming worshipful. You see, our life following Christ is not just an event. It's a series of following. It's a series of events. It's moving from one to the next. It is completing a small part of it, but it... In the issue of following, remember, we don't just have one goal out there. Our goal each day is to follow. And for so long, our culture has been so wrapped up in what our life should look like. And as I explained last week, I don't knock the you've got to love what you do. Because when you love what you do from an area of birth, in what Christ would have you do, when you do that, you will love what you do. Because what you're doing is following God. It's not just the thing that you put your hands to each day. The love occurs in the person who's given you the ability to do it. It's in the person who's shown you that burden, who's asked you to follow him. That's where the love happens. So it's easy to say you should love what you do because what you do is follow God, and you should absolutely love that. It makes the rest of the stuff tolerable. No, we're not going to love our careers. And I'm so proud to be able to teach this from hindsight. From Sherrianne told me I lied as a preacher last week. It's not been 15 years. It's been 13 years. But in preacher years, it's like 27. Yeah. I've heard you double in it. So 13 years, you know. And in no way would I have ever wanted to be a preacher, to be a pastor, to be a church leader, whatever you want to call us now. Because we keep changing our name for some reason. To be just what I am on a daily day basis. I would have never wanted it. Literally told many people, I don't want to. Right? I mean, I grew up a preacher's kid. I mean, I watched deacons act like idiots. Literally watched it happen. It happened. Seen it. No, they're not all that way, but I've seen them act that way. Any of y'all deacons? Okay, good. Go ahead. We have a couple of deacons from up north, and you're not. You're good. But I watch some bad ones, man. I watch church people look at other church people and decide that their sins were worse than their sins. No matter what the sin was, it didn't matter. It was just worse than theirs. And they used it as leverage to make people behave a certain way or to act a certain way or to... You know, to manipulate them in some way. I watched this as a young cat. I got baptized because our baptistry was the coolest thing on the planet. It was a big old metal tank that had been welded and my granddad painted, and I wanted to swim in there really, really bad. And those people were so protective of that tank. I just got saved so I could swim. Not lying. The minute I got baptized, I went back underneath and swam to the ladder. It's huge. I loved it. And after that, I felt pretty worthy that I would then sneak back, swim whenever I wanted, because that holy water was now part of me. But that kind of stuff, I grew up, you know, you can't be there. You're not going in that. Don't touch the baptistry. Why not? That makes sense. We fill ours up. We've literally had youth cannonball parties in there. Now, I didn't authorize them, but I heard about them on YouTube and Instagram. Why do you think I got rid of social media? 47 years old, I finally figured out ignorance is bliss. I don't want to know anymore. I don't want to know. But I grew up in that, just everything was just so yuck. And then God brought me here, and I'm like, no, come on. So he gave us a building with no church people in it. I'm like, I like it. I can do this. Our youth group was our four kids, literally, for a long time. And I had no clue how to start a church or restart a church or whatever you want to call what we did here. I had no clue. So I started asking people, and they gave me horrible advice. They did. I'm not lying. I stopped asking church people how to start church. It's bad. And I started just simply saying, God, I don't know what I'm doing. And there were a few people that agreed with me. But we got to do something. I had the burden. I really did. I had a burden. What are we going to do? What am I going to do here? What's going on? And we started with kids. We went to the community. And we started with the after-school program. I needed a job that could actually pay money because my kids like to eat. And I looked out, and this community hated children. They did. The church community hated children. There was a church on our, they're still here, but they had a kids program on our island, and they hated kids. Another church, whenever a family visited their church, I don't know if it's still this today, they would let them know, you know what, we don't really do kids here. And they would send them away. We had many families that came and like, we've been here, and they've all told us they don't like kids. What do you think about them? I'm like, bring them. Just bring them. Just bring them. So we did that. We went to that church that had that program, and we were like, can we have it? And they were like, please. And I'm like, y'all are idiots. And to this day, I don't get along with many church leaders on the island. I send my dad to do that. He's good at that. He's nice to people, and I just have a tendency to go, man, y'all suck. You really do. You make some stupid decisions. So anyway, that's how we started. A kid program downstairs. And those parents would start to come. And we fed them on Wednesday night. We had meals on Wednesday night. With just people. That's all we did. It was just people gathering together. And like, you know what? At some point, we ought to preach. Have Bible study, whatever. And it over a course of thing, it just kind of happened. Those steps, just but those little steps. I told you a couple weeks ago, if I'd have looked forward into what it was going to take to do it, where we are today, nah. Probably wouldn't have. But that testing of God's faithfulness happened every single day. Every single day, God was faithful. And I know I'm crass or whatever. Is that a good word, John? Is it good for me? It's pretty good. You're not supposed to agree with that part. I know I am. Oh, I got to tell you. I went, hi, Ron. Hi, Jerry. Had a memorial service for their kids yesterday in Virginia who died suddenly. I went up to the funeral. So if I feel a little off today, I got home at 2. I'm doing good. So hi, Ron. Hi, Jerry. They're watching this morning. One of the greatest compliments. I when I go places, I don't try to act like a preacher. I don't try to dress like a preacher. Hey. I dress like your preacher. I don't try to dress like other preachers because I really don't know how other preachers are supposed to dress because I don't know where they got their sense of style, but that stinks. Okay? So I don't do it their way. But I got this compliment, and you might not think it's a compliment, but I think it's a great compliment. I get two compliments in my life that I really, really appreciate. One, you don't look like a preacher. And two, you don't act like a preacher. Both of them I say amen to, and then they go, I kind of sound like a preacher. But those are my comments. And I don't go for that. That's just who I am. Listen, when God birthed this idea in you, don't try to be like everybody else who's ever done what God has birthed you to do. Whatever divine burden he's given you, he cut you out for it, not a cookie cutter out for it. He didn't create all preachers the same. He didn't create all plumbers the same. He didn't create all electricians the same. That's something the world says. What God says is you've got me, and that's our only standard. And I will show you how we're going to do your path. I will show you how we're going to do things my way with you. You just have to do it my way. And my way is probably going to be different than a lot of everybody else's ways. So don't be discouraged when God calls you to do something that you don't think you're equipped to do. Then don't try to get equipped like everybody else who's ever done it gets equipped. That's a myth. It's a myth. I literally hated seminary because I think they cookie cut Christian leaders. I tried it. Not for long, but I tried it because I had to say I went to seminary. I don't have to tell you how long I went. It's just like college. I'm a college attender. I'm a seminary attender. So It's all that matters. It's all that matters. It's all that matters. What has God called you to go do? And what's the very next step? If you've been asked to help with communion this morning, I'll ask you to go meet John in room number one back there, and he'll get you started. And that's our emphasis today. As you come and take part in communion, as you break off that bread and somebody says, Christ's body broken for you, and you dip it in the cup and somebody says, Christ's blood shed for you, I want your next thought to be, I'm ready to move. Next step. I'm ready to take the next step. And God will remind you what that next step was. I didn't even give you all that verse this morning, but that's good. I mean, it's on my notes. Because that's your fear, or that's my fear, is that I'll get weary in doing it. And I want to quit. And I think there's a season for everybody to quit. It's God's season. Whatever it is he's got you doing, you know, certain things going in. It was time for Nehemiah to quit the wall. Yeah, the wall got to a certain height, and that's where he stopped. It's God telling him, that's where we're stopping. Don't be afraid of that either. But don't grow weary in doing it. Don't grow weary, because at the time, at the proper time, you'll reap the harvest. So as you're participating in communion, and you're committing, I'm ready for the next step. Go ahead and say whatever prayer you need to say to be ready for God to show you that step if you don't already know it. But I firmly believe that some of you know the next step. It's just simply taking it. That's what I want to see us do. Take the step. Take the step. I believe our church is ready to take steps. And this year I hope we take them. Well, we're going to take them. Whatever they are. I know God has them planned out. Some of them are scary. Some of them are financial. Some of them are just stretching. Some of you who work around here, don't stretch us anymore, right? We got to stretch until it's done. So we're going to stretch ourselves. And I know that's happening in your life. And I pray that you've got the courage and wisdom to operate in that. Let me pray for you. And then we're going to make our way up. Man, there's a lot of you. Any of y'all here when we tried the traffic pattern sermon? Anybody remember that sermon? I figured out what I did wrong, so we're going to fix it today. There's going to be a communion station in front of each section. You're going to leave your section on that side. You're going to go in front of the station, and then you're going to come back up this your next aisle and go back in your pew. It's novel. I've been here 13 years. We've never done communion without having somebody do a head-on collision. Listen, folks, today's the day. When you take your first step, make sure it's in that direction. And together, we're just going to make these little circles. Let me pray for you, and then you make your way up. God, I thank you for the burden that you've given us. That you've given me. I also thank you for the direction that you'll provide. God, may I do my part in every step I can. May I trust you in every moment. As I tear off this piece, as I dip it, and I commit. God, may I mean what I say, that I will follow you no matter what. In your name we pray. Amen. Y'all make your way up.
The name of Jesus is a refuge, a shelter from the storm, a help to those who call. The name of Jesus is a fortress, a saving place to run, a hope unshakable. When we fall, you are the Savior. When we call, you are the answer. There is power in your name. There is power in your name. In the name of Jesus, there is life and healing. Chains are broken in your name.
Why are you looking for love?
stand together. If you look at the bulletin, the things that are going this week while you're in town, I want you to be a part of, because while you're here, your family, many things go on our campus. 6 days a week is our current occupancy of the campus of things going on. So that's really cool. We're going for seven. I don't know what we're going to do on that sixth day or on that seventh day, but we'll figure it out. But come and be a part of everything that's going on. Family fellowship meals Wednesday night at 5:30, followed by Bible study. It's in our back in the building out back, called the Christian Retreat Center. So come check that out Wednesday. Let's all pray together, and we will move on. God, I thank you for your direction. And now, as we go out of here, that it is clear in our minds what we must do next. In your name we pray. Amen.